taboo, sensual touch. Erotic taboo, sensual touch.
Touch me.
You're listening to the Intimacy Chronicles. Hello, Facebookers, Instagrammers, and YouTubers. Tonight's show, we're going to be talking about love. We have a special guest, Dr. Eric Holmes. He's going to be speaking with us about his book. Let me just show you all the book, The Power of the Seed. And make sure you get your copy on Amazon.
And
Barnes & Noble. So there's a Barnes & Noble everywhere. So you definitely can pick up your copy. It's definitely well worth the read. It's very inspirational, and you'll get a lot out of it. So I'm going to let him talk about his book. But first, I'm going to introduce my co-host. And, of course, Dr. Love is my diva, and he's running a few minutes late. So we'll start with the quiet storm. So,
greetings, everyone. Hope everyone is enjoying the spring solstice, daylight savings time. Greetings.
Okay, so quiet storm haven't been here in a month of Mondays.
A month of Mondays, yeah, that's the best way to say it.
So what's been going on?
Busy. Ooh, life, work. Mm-hmm. That kind of thing, but I definitely miss you guys.
Yeah, I definitely
got
miss
a lot
you.
of catching up to do. So I'll behave though. I'll behave tonight.
You'll behave tonight.
For a
now,
little
are
bit.
You behaving because we have company?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm gonna say I don't think there's a lot that surprises Eric.
Well, all right.
Yeah.
Not nowadays.
And it's interesting because I met Eric at, it was a photo shoot and an event for the launch of Critique Magazine.
Okay.
But he just has such a energy that draws you in, and you feel like you can talk to him about any and everything. He was just like, he was on fire.
Okay. And when was this photo shoot?
A few weeks ago.
Okay.
Yeah, at Studio 23.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was great. It was a lot of interesting people there that I met for the first time, and Eric was one of them. In fact, he's actually on the cover of the magazine Critique Empire.
Oh, which month? Which?
For February.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I got to get my edition.
You definitely got to get your copy. The article was great, and it just inspired you, and it was kind of like a story of triumph and to be comfortable stepping outside of your comfort zone. So it was great. So I'm gonna actually let Dr. Holmes introduce himself, and we'll begin our show.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Eric Holmes. Everybody calls me Dr. E. I'm a native of Harrisburg, PA. Moved to Baltimore 25 years ago, and all in the plan and will of God. Just a humble servant who says yes. 21-year employee of Johns Hopkins. Member of the best church in this side of Jordan, the Bethel Temple, 3910 West Rogers Avenue, with the phenomenal pastor and bishop, the Bishop Pender. And I'm just grateful to be here on Mix Station. I love these guys. You know, it's not my first time here, so I appreciate, you know, the honor to come back, and just want to share, you know, people, how powerful their seed is, and just be an inspirational to encourage other people and to uplift people. So, you know, I'm just grateful.
Yeah, we're grateful to have you here.
Thank you.
So, tell us the motivation behind the book.
The motivational behind The Power of the Seed, as I often share, is I asked God one, I prayed like 1 a.m., well, actually 12 midnight, 1 a.m., 5 a.m. And so one Saturday morning, I came down stairs one Saturday morning to pray. And I was asking God for a project to be a blessing to ministry, to my pastor and first lady, always want to be a blessing, and to do something for the kingdom. And so after praying, I walked into the kitchen. It was about like 5:30 in the morning. And I opened the door to the deck, and I have a tree in my yard, which actually had changed colors. This is the first time in like 10 years that I had seen it change like that. And all I kept hearing was, your season has just changed. Your season just changed. And then next thing I know, like, heard the Lord speak, put it in a book, The Power of the Seed. So immediately I started drawing, got some paper out. So I'm standing in the kitchen 5:30 something in the morning, and I'm drawing, you know, which is actually this tree here. And then what I did was send it to a buddy of mine who is a graphic designer. Mm-hmm. And I was like, this is what I want. And they're probably like, what in the world is somebody sending me something at 5:30 in the morning? But when God gives you vision, when God gives you something to do, you know, a lot of times we procrastinate, but I immediately begin to put it into action. So begin to put my faith in action, begin to put this vision that he gave me into action, because a lot of times we can miss the door of opportunity. We can miss the season. We can miss what God has for us because we procrastinate and we don't act upon it. Mm-hmm. So I begin instantly to work with it, what he gave me.
And so in the process of writing, I mean, because I'm sure there were times where you questioned what you were doing, or because it's something that you wouldn't ordinarily do. So what did you do during those times? How did you keep yourself motivated to continue?
The motivational and with continuing, and anytime, I just was asked this question actually today. Mm-hmm. Someone was saying in reference about writing a book, I said, well, everybody has a story. Mm-hmm. Just write it. It's right there because it's in you, but you've got to start. So my motivational was, God gave me a vision. God gave me a dream. I asked for something. God gave it. I didn't think it was a book. Uh-huh. But what he gave me, I took it, and I began to act upon what he gave me. And so the thing was, my motivational of going is because I asked God for this. And the thing about it was, and what I was desiring to do and where I wanted to go and the blessing I wanted to be. So he gave it to me, so I had to act upon it. And a lot of times we ask for things, but then we're not really or willing to do what has been given.
I agree.
You know, a lot of people ask for a lot of things, or, you know, that's not just a cliche when people say, be careful what you pray for, because you just might get it. No, you're going to get it if you get it, but then what are you going to do with it?
That's it. Yeah. I think that's an interesting point, because a lot of times we ask for things that we're not quite ready to partake in.
Mm-hmm.
We want it, but we're still not ready to put the work into it.
Right.
And when things don't go according to plan, instead of looking within, we're looking at all the situations surrounding it and blaming other people for the lack of effort that we put into mm-hmm. something. I think when you ask for something, you have to know that you are going to commit to it 100%.
Yes.
And I think that's a lot of times what's lacking, is that commitment. You have to continue. I mean, you're going to get discouraged, but you can't give up. You have to believe in your own power.
You do.
Yeah. And I think that's kind of where, you know, some of us might fall short. So to see someone who actually wrote a book for the first time and believed enough in himself to share that power with other people is very inspirational. And I hope that it will encourage others to tell their story too. Because as you mentioned, we do all have a story.
Yes.
And it could benefit, even if it's just one person. That's one person that will go on to do probably some amazing things and healing, you know, with your story. So I just think that I applaud you. And I really applaud you. And like I said, when I met you, you just had an energy about you that just spoke positive. You know, it was You were just so happy.
Yeah, and that's what I tell a lot of people. Not that we don't have problems, situations, or we don't go through things, but as my pastor always says, and he said it Sunday, you got to see the plus wrapped up in the minus. You got to see there's always a negative and a positive, but the energy connects. But what are you going to do? And I when God gave me something with the book, I said, you've always got to see it from another perspective. You got to see it different. Like even now, I write an inspirational for my department. And one of the things I wrote, I'm exiting my winter and I'm entering my spring. Though winter's trying to hang on, I still see spring. Because my mindset is I see spring. Or as Dr. Love was saying, you know, when we're looking at things from another perspective, how do I see it? I'm changing my mindset. I'm changing my garment. I'm getting ready for the new. I'm getting ready to what was to what is. So a lot of times if our mind and our perception and our perspective is still in the past, we'll never get to the present or the future because we're still holding on. We know that the spring is coming. And even though winter's still holding on, but how do you see it now? How do you see it different? So our inspiration and how we're trying to help other people or being an inspiration. And when you talked about the book, like someone asked me today and I was like, well, what's been poured into me and what's been shared with me, let me share it with you. As I was saying when we talked at, you know, the release for the magazine. But if you don't believe in the vision or your brand, your dream, your business, who is going to believe in it? You've got to believe it. And I said to them, you've got to sell it. If I'm trying to get this position and everybody else, what makes me the better employee? What makes me stand out more than them? What makes the power of the seed stand out? One, as the publisher said, the CEO said, you know, they can look at the cover and determine whether they're going to buy your book. What is it about this? But it's going to gravitate. The power of the seed is something that's going to draw you. Your brand, your vision, when they look at mix station radio, what is it about this station as opposed to the other station? What am I selling? What is my brand? But if I don't believe in my vision, my brand, who is going to believe in it? I've got to promote it. You know, people are saying, I'm seeing you like everywhere. But it's work. It's a process. It's preparation. Because just like now that my book's in all these libraries, but I had to first open up my mouth. I had to go there. You know, it wasn't just going to get on these shelves in Baltimore County, Baltimore City, Dauphin County, and PA. It wasn't just going to get there if I never went there, one, or if I never said to them, when I walked in, I said, oh, I look right at these shelves. I said, well, what do I need to do to get my book? My book belongs on your shelf. She said, well, do you have one with you? Absolutely. Always be prepared. Always come prepared, but then be ready to present. She said, you have your ID? Do you have a library card? They were asking all of this, but sometimes we're not prepared. Yeah. We're not ready. You, whether it's your brand, your business, you bet everywhere I go, listen, I sold books at funerals, on the plane, sitting next to a gentleman who holds a high position. When we were on our ministry trip, we got to talking. He opened up his laptop. He asked me about it, and he downloaded my book right sitting beside me on the plane. I said, well, look, I got you know, some hoodies with me. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't afraid. Then I said, well, I'm doing a book signing. If you're able to come from D.C., here's the... You've got to be ready. Be prepared. But like my pastor said, if you don't open up your mouth, the same is we want God to bless us, but we're not going to open up our mouth.
Right.
Or as they say, a closed mouth don't get fed. Yeah. You've got to be willing. And whether they say no, that's all they say, yes or no. The chairman of my department, hey, my book is in the newsletter. I wasn't afraid to ask. Mm-hmm. Hey, they need to buy. Listen, you need to buy the powder. It's going to bless you. Right. Why is it going to bless you? And then I go to explaining it.
Yeah. And being able to do that is a belief in yourself. You know,
yes.
Like, yeah, because you have to have that. You can't, if you're shy, how do you expect to move forward? You got to believe in your dream.
You do.
Yeah. And you got to put that work into your dream because it's just not going to go to the next level with no work. You know, so I applaud you for being able to approach anybody about, listen, this book will benefit you, or how can I get it on your shelves? Because you wouldn't ordinarily know the answer without not opening your mouth. So I applaud you for that. For someone that's interested in writing a book, what would be your words of encouragement to them?
My words of encouragement to them, first, everything's with me, one is so critical, is prayer. for me to get direction, for me to pray, Lord, give me direction, guide me. You know, and even for people that don't believe, you know, the thing about it is that you've got to know, write it down, write out a plan. I tell people, even with your vision, your board, but you got to do something with it. You can't just write stuff, but then you got to do your research. Get a mentor. Not only that, get somebody to where you're trying to go. Like one of the ladies, hopefully she's on here, who I talked about doing this anthology with, and I'm so excited because, you know, Miss Cheryl Polo Williamson is amazing. Mm-hmm. Award-winning, best-selling author. Listen, philanthropist. I mean, she's amazing. But she pours into me. She gives me the wisdom, knowledge. You know, she got 12 books. They all bestsellers. Mm-hmm. So to have someone like that to pour into you, now I can pour into somebody else to help them, but get a mentor. Get somebody that can pour into you. But then you got to do the research, and you got to do some work. Mm-hmm. I was going to the library. When I had to do this, I was going to the library, looking stuff up. You can't just write stuff down and you do no work. It's process. It's preparation. You got to put the work in. You know, people want to say, I want to be a millionaire, but can you handle what you already have? Yeah. You know, people say, well, I want to be like Oprah. I want to be like Steve. But what are you doing? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? What are you preparing? Are you preparing? Are you in the process? I mean, are you going to the library? Are you doing the work? Are you doing your research? Are you doing your homework? And you got to make sure, whether it's your clothing line, whether it's say, you got to make sure you got stuff in writing. Make sure you get stuff. Yeah, like for all my stuff, 300 Preston Street, eighth floor. Exactly. It's in writing. It's in the archives. Yeah. 5 to 7 years, I don't have to renew it. But you got to have all your stuff in order. You can have a vision, an ideal. God gave me the power of the seed. Mm-hmm. Somebody else could have thought of it, because mine is not documented. They take your ideal and run with it. Not,
that's true.
Yeah. You got to be prepared. But I tell them like this, I carry all my documents around. You use it, you're going to have to go to court. Yeah.
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? But yeah, if you don't have that type of stuff, or if it's not you, whether it's trademark, branded, all of this stuff, and then you got to know people. Like I posted something in reference to one of the clothing lines, and I have a friend on there, they're a lawyer. Well, you got to have it. You know, there's a difference between the branding, the trademark. You know, they made sure I had all this and posted the link. Mm-hmm. So we got to make sure we have the right information, because information is knowledge, and knowledge is power.
Absolutely. I don't
want to. Well, one of the things they say, because I'm listening to you, and I'm listening to your passion, which is really striking. I commend you for that. What kind of advice would you have for people? Like, for instance, one of the biggest tragedies in for young people, young men, is wasted talent. Mm-hmm. So when you see a talented person with potential and wants to embark on that dream, as far as your elevator conversation, what would you say to them to get them moving towards their passion?
One, because I have a nephew who is a phenomenal mm-hmm. artist, always pushing them, always pulling out. You need somebody that can pull the vision and dreams out of you. Mm-hmm. You need someone that has your best interests at heart. So when I see talent in people, always encourage them, be the best. Do what you got to do, helping them. What can I do my part to help you? Give them words of encouragement. And sometimes you got to sow. Sometimes you got to see. Give them the information. They may not know to go over here to, you know, the Enoch Pratt Library and look at section 3644 or something like that. Give them the information. Help them along the way. But then make sure they do the work. Now, they got to put in the work, but help them. Give them the direction. Give them some wisdom. And sometimes you got to be transparent. Yeah, I might have failed in this area, but this is how I pick myself. I don't get stuck there. I don't stay there. But how can I get from here? You know what I mean? We made some errors. We made some mistakes. You know, writing this book. Yeah, sometimes I had to write some stuff over, or, you know what I mean, make sure the grammar's right. But then when I sent it in to the publishing company, they sent in the corrections back. I had a coach, which was phenomenal. I do have a wonderful book publishing company, y'all. Purposely Creative Publishing, phenomenal. But I had a coach, you know, so all my corrections, you know, I had somebody helping me. So now I can in turn help somebody else. But a lot of times we don't share information. We don't push people. You know, when I was doing that interview with her for Critique Man, I'm saying, listen, not because I'm on the cover, but I'm just trying to push your brand. I'm on enough magazines, in enough magazine, but I'm trying to push your brand. You know why I'm pushing my own? How can we help somebody else along the way? Because in the words of the late Apostle Evan, he said, what you make happen for others, God will make happen for you. When you able to help somebody else, God will in turn help you. And a lot of times we don't find that. So when you find talent in people, and I say it like this, let's get them before the streets get them. Because a lot of times all this talent go to waste. Or, you know, one of my spiritual brothers, you know, did 12 years, phenomenal, just wrote a book, you know, a 30-day inspiration. And it's amazing. Josh Proby, look him up, y'all. I mean, he's doing amazing work, but he's telling his story. He's helping other people. He didn't get stuck. We can't get stuck in our process. We can't get stuck in the middle of it. We got to move forward. You'll never move forward. So push somebody else. Help them. Encourage them. But then give them the information, because a lot of people don't know where to go.
Okay. Well, how much of your advice, because very, very inspirational, and which I definitely appreciate. So how much of advice to people, like, for instance, you go to church and, you know, you start singing and you sound good. You think you sound good, but you don't sound good. And then those ladies in the church with all the peppermint say, honey, stay in your gifted area.
Yeah.
So how much have you ever come across, how do you address someone's dream, someone's passion to realistic success?
You got to deal with the whole reality of it. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, I literally just talked about this right before I came here, mm-hmm. and was saying that a lot of times people are in the wrong lanes.
Yes.
People are operating, whether if and I was just saying this, if I'm a usher and I'm trying to be, you know, the psalmist, and I know I can't sing.
Right.
You know what I mean? You can work at a gift or your craft or whatever it is, but a lot of times you got to know what your passion is. You got to know what your calling. You got to know what your giftings are. Right. Like, I know I'm good at network. I know I'm good at encouragement. I know I'm good at being an inspiration. I know that. You know, I know working in healthcare, working with patients and helping people. But then if you're trying to operate out of something, you really are not really going to be successful. And we base success on materialistic things.
Absolutely.
You know, I love my pastor, Bishop Pendon. I love Apostle, you know, the late Apostle Evans, how they poured so much into me. Said, wealth is being able to get it when you need it. We base it on, and if I seek ye first the kingdom, all that other stuff is going to be added. We base it on materialistic things. You look at Katrina, you look at so many storms and hurricanes, all that stuff is wiped away. So what do you base your success on? Do you base it on this materialistic stuff that now it's all gone, that you got to start over, you know, because of a tragedy or because of something happened, that a storm showed up unannounced, unaware? We wasn't asking for it, but it showed up. So how do you deal with it now that you lost everything? So the mere fact is success is being able to get it when you need it, and we can't just base it on materialistic things. I'm successful if I'm finished writing this book. I did a step. I made it to get to the point where now it's not just a vision, it's not just a dream, but here it is, the manifestation of the reality, that now it's on the shelf, or now it's on Amazon, on Barnes & Noble, or I'm able to sit here and bring it here.
But if it wasn't on Barnes & Noble, if it wasn't on Amazon, would you still be successful?
I'm still successful because it's done.
That's
the whole process of it. Right. I did it. I didn't stop in the middle of the process.
Uh-huh.
I finished it. Just like with a race, or even when the scripture says the race is not given to the swift nor the battle to the strong. The whole thing is that I endure. It's not how fast I run. It's that I endure. It's not how I start, but how I finish. Now, I may have started out, say it could have been 2018, but I might not finish to 2019. But the mere fact is, I finish.
Good, good. I like that.
How has the book impacted your life? Because I know now you're like a overnight celebrity, especially at work. So how is it for you now having the book out?
You know, I'm just humble servant. I'm just glad God allowed me to be in his plan, and it's a privilege, mm-hmm. to be able to share. It's a privilege that he's given me you know, this whole vision. It's a privilege that he's allowed me to share what he's given me to now share with the world. And the thing about it is, you know, even at work, from the president on down, they support me, they encourage, they always say, you're going to be a millionaire, just don't forget about me. I said, I won't, because you've been inspirational. And so wherever I go, to be able to talk about the power of the seed to bless somebody else. And it's not just, it's from the natural to the spiritual, but then the whole process of dealing with seed, and now we're entering into a, what we call seed time and harvest. So to be able to share that from believers, non-believers, because everything starts with a seed, you know, and from the natural to the spiritual, the whole process of the middle process of it that you share. Just like Saturday after I left the funeral, I went, you know, to get a pedicure, walked into the shop, and the young lady's like, I know you, I know you. And I'm looking like, okay, weird. Oh, wait, what church you go to? That's why, too, we got to have integrity, credibility, and character. Because let me tell you, she was like, I know you. What church you go to? Right there. Mm-hmm. Could have been a whole, when I shared it, she said, oh, wow, I visit y'all a couple times. I love your church. I love your pastor. You was going forth. She even knew the color suit I had on and the color socks, because she said, when you lifted up your pants leg, the socks matched your suit. And I said, wow. But she said, but it was just something how you just was just a blessing. And then we got to talking about the power to see. She said, you have your book with you. I said, absolutely. So when then that, it blessed her, because I began to minister to her and share with her, then end up talking to the young lady beside who just lost her cousin to a murder in the streets. That's why we got to get them for the streets. Get them. And all of that in a conversation. But somebody, I say this all the time, my pastor says it all the time, somebody's always watching. Yeah. Somebody is always watching, because I didn't know the girl. I didn't see her at our church. I didn't know her. You know, and the thing about it was, and I was led to go back, because when I went there maybe a month ago, the Oriental lady wasn't too nice. And I was saying, ma'am, you cut my foot, you know, and then they got to talking in that language and all. Right. So I said, I'm not going back. So right there. But I was led to go back, and I could have missed a whole opportunity that got not obeying, because I was thinking about that Oriental lady, right, but not thinking about the assignment and not thinking about obeying when I was led to go back, end up ministering to the lady. Not because the one bought the book, but I know it's going to bless her. But then they begin to share what they were going through.
Okay. Well, you never know who you inspire.
That's true.
You know, yeah. You never know. So, you know, as you're doing your daily and your due diligence, you never know who's watching you. And that's a good testimony.
Yes.
And it's so simple to touch a life. I think sometimes we forget that, because you feel like, well, sometimes you feel that if you can't help somebody financially, you can't do anything for them. But it's so, just a kind word, you can touch somebody's life. That That's kindness it. Can make the world a difference in mm-hmm. someone's life. And I think that we take that for granted a lot of times. We take our own ability to heal for granted. Because if he's having a bad day and I offer him some kindness, it's going to make a difference to him, because it shows that I care.
Yes.
You know. Yeah. So we have our first caller for Dr. Holmes. Who do we have on the line?
Hello, this is World of Knuckles.
Bless you, man of God.
Bless you, sir. I said, I'm taking a break from the rehearsal. I said, let me call in and talk to my friend.
I appreciate you,
welcome
man.
Welcome back to McStation, sir. Welcome back to McStation. Yeah, man. So what's the topic tonight? I didn't even see what the topic was tonight. I'm just jumping. Just calling.
We just talking tonight? It up.
We just, yeah.
The seed, that's the topic. The seed. You need to read.
Power of the seed.
The power of the seed. Absolutely.
The power of the seed. Well, I must say, the power of the seed is great. I've read the book. I love the book. And if anybody out there, please get the book, The Power of the Seed. Earl Combs is probably, I mean, he breaks it down simple and plain. And it has a lot to do with the seed. You know, you reap what you sow. And one thing I say, you reap and bad stuff, you'll reap bad stuff. If you reap good stuff, you'll get good stuff. And that's the bottom line, you know, and to reap into the ground. And I must say that, you know, with him teaching, especially getting this book out all around the world, amen, it's just wonderful to see him rolling on, you know, do everything and just let know, just talk to my friends.
Bless
you know,
bro.
Hopefully I can get there before y'all leave, but I don't know. So, you know, I'm still racist, so, you know, but God.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. So I'm just going to say bye for now. I'll see y'all later. And, you know, good to see you, bro. Good to hear you on the radio station again.
Bless you, man. God. All
right.
You, all right,
family. All right, bless you.
All right, thank you.
And see, that's just inspiration, because when I talk about integrity and character and credibility, I was here before. Now, just you invited me here, they could have been like, oh, well, you know, we don't, you know. That's why you never know. You've got to be very careful. I didn't know I was going to meet you there. Mm-hmm. It was already done in eternity manifested in time. But the timing and season is everything. And I tell people that. And the other thing is, when you, whatever it is you're doing, always operate in the timing and season of God. I couldn't have wrote this book no earlier or no sooner. Yeah. It had to be within the timing and season of God, you know. And the thing it is, sometimes we operate out of the timing and season. Everything doesn't grow in the right season, the same timing. But when we operate in timing and season, just like from the whole process of the farmer with the planting of the seed, mm-hmm. he's got to do the work before he can even do any of that. Mm-hmm. He's got to toil the ground. He's got to get it ready, got to make sure the ground's ready before he does any of the planting. Then once he plants, then he still got to do some work. He got to do the whole middle process. And I tell people, don't get stuck in the middle of the process. And you can't rush the process, mm-hmm. nor can you rush the seed. And it is, we try to rush things. And then sometimes, you know, I put a quote in my book from the late Apostle Evans. You know, I love my late Apostle Evans and my Bishop Pender. They've poured so much in Bishop, my current pastor now. And the thing is that he said it like this: I don't want anything prematurely because I might not be able to handle it. Mm-hmm. We want a lot of things, but we're trying to rush it. You can't rush a cake and take it out too soon. You're going to have an undone product. If you didn't mix all the ingredients in it, if you didn't prepare it, if it didn't go through the necessary preparation and the process, you're not going to have a good product. Right. If you try to rush the seed, and see, that's why I love about a farmer. See, he sees from the beginning, but yet he sees the end. But then he work in the middle of the process. He's nurturing it. He's watering it. He's harvesting it. So when it gets to the set time and season, now he got to harvest. And guess what? It may not even be the same year. So he's starting the process all over again. We've got to go through the process, the preparation. We've got to be prepared, get ready. We want things like I put this in the book, a microwavable age. We want everything instantly. Oh, yeah. It won't last. You can even, from the spiritual, when the old mothers had you around the altar tarrying for the Holy Ghost, you couldn't just get up and say, oh, I got, no, get back down. You're not ready. Mm-hmm. And we're rushing things. And we want things too fast. And that's why we don't keep things. That's why things don't last. People want all this, like, look at Oprah or look at so many different people, but yet there was a process. Look when she was in Baltimore.
Exactly.
So you looking at her now, she had to go through a process. We all have our own process. Or even as I said, we all have our own cross to bear.
Yeah.
And you do. Don't rush things. You know how we used to, I can't wait till I get grown. I bet you wish you thought you was a child now. All these bills, mortgages, car notes, all of this. But we want to rush things. And we all have done it. But the mere fact is the older you get, you ain't trying to rush no time away. You see what I'm saying? So the whole process, you know, don't rush it. It's going to come. The timing and season is everything. You know, for women that are having a baby, you don't want it to come too early,
right?
Because you have a 50-50 chance. You already even have a 50-50 chance when delivering it. But yet and still, there's the whole process of it. And I used to work in OBGYN, so I know a lot about that and the trimesters and all of that. But yet you don't want it to come at, say, 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to go through the process. Now, we know sometimes it can come, you know, because God's timing, however, you know,
yeah.
He's in control. But the mere fact about it is he's in control of it, you know, so we can't rush things. And too many times we're rushing things. You know, all of this work I'm putting in, this didn't just start today.
Right.
You know, I've been seeding, I've been planting, I've been tithing, I've been sowing. So I'm just holding God to his word of what he says. I'm standing on the word and the promises of God. And so I expect God. He said, ask, it shall be given. Ask me. We have not because we ask not.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Love.
quiet.
I've been listening. I mean, there's a lot that was said.
And this stuff is deep, man. I'm sitting here like...
a lot that was said.
I realized when I met him, I knew that when he would, whenever his time was to come on the show, I knew that it was going to be motivational. I knew that he would light a fire under somebody, because I think sometimes you go to events and you never know who's going to have an impact on you.
I feel like I could fly right now.
That's what I'm saying. And so after, well, you remember when we did the interview with him and he was getting ready to walk away because, you know, I thought we were finished. And then he said, let me share something else with you. And so it was like ongoing. So I felt like even in that moment, a fire was lit. And sometimes you just don't know the impact that a person will have on your life. But what I knew was I wanted him to share his message with our listeners, because I just feel like he's very motivational. And I know at work, even prior to you doing the book, you were probably still that person that motivated everyone. And I think that's an amazing gift to have, to be able to captivate and motivate. Like you said, you plant the seed in someone. Someone that reads this book, it may inspire them to come up with some new technology that could cure cancer. You just never know. It's because it is the power of the seed.
And it's amazing you said that, because writing this book, I used to work in our pet center, which we deal with cancer patients. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing because now and then this year, I'm working on the other side of it, still with a lot of cancer people. But I did a conference as the speaker in January out at our Green Spring location. And quite a few of the patients were there, and they, you know, they bring families. It's a support group, and I was honored. I dealt with health and healing, how to connect the two. And it was amazing because so many of the patients remembered me from the old department, but yet they see me in a new department. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you how the timing and season of God, and how God will cause things to manifest. One of the gentlemen said to me, and then he ended up shutting it down because we were all in tears. He said, let me tell you how you helped me get through this 12 years of cancer, and now I'm cancer free. He said to me, your energy in the morning, your smile, and just being energetic helped me to get through. And those tests are 2.5 hours. So, but it whether it's an issue, whether it's the consultation, whether it is just restaging, it affects their whole life of the next treatment that they have to do. So here it is. I could have been mean. And just to see this man several years later at this conference that I was asked to be the speaker for. Look how, if I could have been doing a total different thing. That's why we got to see things from a different perspective, and how we got to be so conscious, you know, of what we're doing. And when people say, well, I don't care what people think, you should, because you have no idea. Not because all of us are unrighteous. It's because of the blood, the glory of God, the grace and mercy. But I thank God he placed me in those positions, because that thing brought something to me and brought tears. I could have been at work or not been a good employee, and, you know, coming in mad and all this. And here it is, several years later, I'm speaking at a conference, sitting at the head of the conference table with these people that I helped, that I didn't even know, because it we got so emotional in there. And then the other gentleman was like, wait a minute, I know you. You know, and it was a whole domino effect. But then I get to this department, and one of the gentlemen the other day said, wait a minute, that's the gentleman with the bow tie from the other department. Me and my wife talks about you. We only got to come every year now, seeing them being healed. And he said, wow, we always say you're the best dressed gentleman in the hospital. You're the nicest. And wow, just seeing you now just brought some. And I was at the front desk. I'm like, wow, I'm getting ready to get emotional. But just the mere fact, it's all to God's glory. It's all that he allowed me to be in. That's why when we go to, we can't just say, oh, this is a job, it's a paycheck.
Right.
It's ministry. Mm-hmm. I didn't know I was going to meet you there, but God's timing, God knew. It wasn't just, we go for one thing, God allows something else to happen. I thought I'm going to just to support this release because I'm on the cover of the magazine. Yet and still, look how God allowed things to shift and turn for us to be sitting here. It's the timing and season of God. So I don't take it for granted. Any opportunity to share, any opportunity to bring him glory, any opportunity that I might can encourage somebody else. Everybody's going through something. Everybody's dealing with something. Like I said, if I didn't obey and go and get that pedicure just because the lady wasn't nice, the last time in there, I would have missed two opportunities. These two young ladies share. I mean, they didn't care who was in there. But because they needed a word, she said, no, keep going. We need a word in this place. I need a word. This is where I am in my life. I could have missed the greatest opportunity to help somebody else. Because I would have thought about the lady who wasn't, you know, I didn't go to that lady though. But the other lady, she shifted from one area. Let me tell you, God will position you. Listen, for obedience is better than sacrifice. He shifted her. She just finished her client because she takes appointments and shifted. I said, oh, wow. She shifted from one area to another. I didn't even know she did the pedicures. Wow.
And if you would have spoke Korean, you could have ministered to the lady doing your pedicure.
Yeah. And that's true, but I'm sure they heard all of that too, because they know English. Because when it comes down to taking money, they know it. They know that English.
Yeah,
but the mere fact is, we miss opportunities. We could have been like, that's why with the woman with the issue, she didn't miss that moment, that greatest opportunity to get what she needed. And a lot of times we miss the moment.
We miss the moment.
And that's why our focus, our determination, our drive. I told God, I want everybody around the world to hear about this. Not for me, because I just wrote. It's not because this is not just a book.
Right.
This is ministry. It's not just that. It was God inspired, because I wouldn't think about writing a book.
Right.
I asked for a project to be a blessing. And see, that's the other thing. Mm-hmm. We don't know how God is sending what he's sending. And when we ask for something, are we really willing and ready? When I say, and I'm going to share this because this is how it's really going to bless. Last summer, literally 4 months of the summer was crazy with the one department I used to go with, and I still prayed for them, still forgave them. And literally nobody but several people, my parents, just not a lot of people. And this is going to help encourage, because I don't just share it unless God allows me to share it. But I literally walked away from being there 20 years and nobody ever knew it. Because I said, God, this, I can't deal with this, you know, but the mere fact is I still had to turn around and pray for it. I still had and still fighting for my money, because I told them I'm going all the way until they release it. But yet and still, God had this position waiting for me. And then I told him to operate in faith and no finding, had to operate and trusting. You talk about trusting and believing God. But in the middle of that process, I never forgot to give God praise. I never forgot to give him glory, ministering to other people when they didn't even know my situation. But the mere fact is, I watched God give me a letter. They came in, did $5,000 worth of weatherization to my home. Like literally a letter out of nowhere. I called them. And I was like, well, who are you? You know, but not only that, I would have never walked in that library. From that day, my book has been in all of 22 locations of the Baltimore County, 19 of Baltimore City, 22, 19 of Baltimore County, and 8 and Dauphin County in PA. Had that process, had that not taken place. See, that's why we can't look at, we think something is a tragedy that he's going to turn into a triumph that's going to bring us victory. That's why I couldn't get stuck in the middle of the process. But God will always give you a word. He said, don't compromise your promise and settle for less. It's worth the wait. So in my wilderness, my promise on the other side of the wilderness, I'm in the middle of the process. I couldn't stop right there. I had to keep on going. But he has now expanded the power of the sea. I'm going to a conference in May. I got a TV interview in Atlanta. You know what I mean? I'm going to India in September. It's nobody but God. When I talk about process, when I talk about timing and season, when I talk about being faithful to God, I'm telling you, it's worth it. And everybody on it, it is worth being faithful to God. I don't care what the storm is. I don't care what the, and most people never even knew it. My smile didn't, my praise, I was still at service. I was still in ministry. Nobody knew. But what I did, what he gave me with my clothing line, Favor Will Change the Rules, The Power of the Sea, my book. Let me tell you, you talk about execute. That's my new clothing line coming out, y'all. I got a shirt on today. It's called Execute. Execute the promise, the plan, the vision, the dreams, the goals. And guess what? Let me tell you, that whole month of that summer, I mean, when I say I sold so many books, shirts, and that, but the drive, you got to have it. But God was allowing me to see another part of it that, yes, he's my source. Mm-hmm. He is my source. So don't ever get stuck in the middle of the process. And don't ever forget to give him praise. Don't ever forget to tell him thank you. And everybody has what played a part. Don't forget to tell these people thank you. That's why everybody that has been a part, like Mixed Radio, thank you. You know, Kish Magazine, thank you. Dr. Kishma George, thank you. You know, Miss Cheryl Williams, thank you. You know what I mean? Critique Magazine, thank you. You know what I mean? WMSK Radio, thank you. You know, Worldwide Flavor, Baltimore Flavor, Network Radio, thank you. WEA, thank you. Every radio station, every personnel, everybody that's played a part. Miss Tammy Collins, Millionaires and Trainee Radio, thank you. Being on the cover this month of Dynasty Dreamer, thank you. Every single person, don't forget to tell people thank you, because a thank you will open up room for more. You begin to tell God thank you, it'll open up room for more. This whole thing is nothing about, but it's all about God. And I say, God, that I could be able to encourage and help somebody else, that you don't have to get stuck. I don't care what mistake, or if you fail, or you think you're not, you're getting stagnated, you got to keep on going. That turtle in the hair, that illustration I put in this book, it wasn't how fast he was going. He kept on going. So here it is. The rabbit takes a break and laughs at him. Guess what? He kept right on going. Cross the finish line. Keep on going. You're going to cross the finish line, and other people going to be sitting right there watching you as you cross the finish line. Don't get weary while doing good. Right. I couldn't get stuck. Nobody even knew it. But the president, she said, you coming back to this because your inspiration is needed. I need you back on this campus. Let me tell you, she always emails me and tells me. And like I said, to be a blessing to be a speaker there, that's amazing. It's nobody but God. I'm speaking in April. Nobody but God. Nobody but God. So it's all about God. And I thank God for the process, because he had to prepare me. I couldn't have wrote this chapter in this book that I'm writing had I not experienced it. So, you know, I'm just ever grateful. And I'm just an humble servant. I'm telling you, I just thank God for every opportunity. And we don't take it. It's not just being on the radio. It's not just being in the line. I done been on a whole lot of radio. I'm doing one Wednesday. Like, it's no, but it's to get the word. It's to help and encourage somebody else. Your dream, your vision. And I keep this on the refrigerator. Dream big. A dream is only when you can see it. But don't stop dreaming until you see the reality, until you see the manifestation of it. Dreams do come true. It's only when you stop dreaming. I know this is going to be an international. I know it's going to be one. I'm in an international magazine. I was on the cover for the August issue of Upwards Magazine. Shout out to Kolkata, India. Thank you. But it's already in India. So this is what I'm saying. God will, your gift will make room for you. Let God do it. We don't have to tear nobody down. We don't have to discredit nobody, because that is a dangerous thing. Envy, jealousy, and discrediting people, because it's true in here. That which a man soweth, that he's going to also reap. When you plant, it's coming. It's going to grow. Let me tell you, it may not be, you may not even see it coming. And it may not reach you. It may reach someone else. That's why we got to be mindful. This word is still true. God is not mocked. Be not deceived. God is not whatsoever a man soweth. So if you plant in, that's why I said you got to make sure the ground is good. You got to make sure the soil is good. Every ground's not good ground. So we can't just plant and sow anywhere. I can't say I want an apple tree if I'm trying to plant oranges. I need to be in Florida or wherever it is. You know, I can't be, they grow in different climates. They grow in different seasons. And we're trying to operate out of the wrong season, out of the wrong timing. And I can't operate in your season. You know what I mean? I'm not the radio host, or you know what I mean? And we're operating in outside of the wrong errors.
Yeah. Right. In the gifted area.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. Yep. Interesting. So right now, you in a good you in a good season in your life, you would say? where you're harvesting a lot of the things that you've sown, and some of the toils of your past is starting to see benefits. Where do you see yourself 5 years from now? Doing what?
Wow, and it's amazing because I get so uh-huh. into it. It's amazing because I have a 5-year plan. When okay. this happened during the summer, I wrote a 5-year plan because one, I'm not going to be causing nobody's vision and everything to soar. I'm working on my own, but I got a plan because I'm going back to school in the spring.
Okay.
Let them pay for it. But see, I'm going on my own business. I already got the ground, put the oil, went around it, prayed, sent it to my prayer partner in North Carolina. It's in the prayer room on the wall. He reminded me the other day, what are you doing? Who do I need to call? What investor's name do I need to call? So see, you need people that you can allow your vision and your dreams, but they got your best interest at heart. Sure. When it comes to business and contract, I go to my pastor. I tore a contract up. If he says this, because he's a businessman of the first magnitude, then he's the watchman of my soul. And not only that, he got my best interest at heart.
Hey, somebody you can trust.
Yeah. Right. You yeah. need people that you mm-hmm. can trust. And you can't share everything with everybody until the manifestation. And we know that from Joseph. But you can't share everything with everybody. So in 5 years, I'm going to travel, uh-huh. be a motivational speaker. I'm retired, get my benefit, and keep it moving.
Okay. But you know what? I'm taking mental notes as you talk. Now, part of that, you made a point. I just want to stop you really quick. You said you can't share everything with everybody. So it sounds like you have a good take on, or you have a good perspective on people that you can trust, people absolutely. That got your best interest at heart.
Yes, absolutely.
And for lack of a better word, haters who will tear you down or keep you from moving forward. So some of those people you have to kind of ignore. And in order for you to move forward, so how do you weed them out of your circle? I mean, how do you, when you have negative people or when you have negative because it's a difference. It's a difference when somebody's being constructive criticism mm-hmm. versus people just saying, nah, don't buy no house.
Right. That's
you know,
what,
don't buy no house. No, don't get no job, man. Don't work for them. You know, I'm saying it in jest, but I think mm-hmm. you understand what I'm talking about.
I am, and I'm glad you said that because mm-hmm. one, see, first of all, prayer is that's my passion. That's my mantle.
Okay.
Not only that, the Holy Ghost is not going to lead me wrong. But see, this is how you have to do it. And God gave me a word. See, you can't ignore the warning signs. You proceed with caution. See, you watch as well as pray. You see it and you keep it moving. But see, even when they don't, that's why when he talks about he'll prepare a table, I know it's a whole lot of people. But it's okay because they'll have to watch me. They'll have to watch the table be spread. And it's okay because I'm still praying for them. But see, what's going to get them? Is to see the favor on my life. What's going to get them is to see me. And one thing I do know, I walk in the favor of God. Yeah. I know that without a shadow of doubt. His faithfulness, his favor. And that's why when he gave me one of my clothing, favor will change the rules. Listen, I mean, from the job, from believers to non-believers, and it will. But then you got to understand and know it's all going to come. It's in the Word.
Yeah.
Jesus, it's all in the Word. So nothing takes us by surprise. You just got to know how to handle it. You just got to know what to do. Or as one of the songs that the choir, the voices of Christ, if you want to know God's will for you, just get in the Spirit. See, he'll show you things. He'll show you. But he'll show you things. And the thing, that's why when people say, well, when do you sleep? Because I pray at 12 midnight, 1 a.m. and 5. And see, that's the thing. Prayer is my life. Prayer is the key. And the thing is, I know people. And even when they don't, I can smile and keep it moving. And then I do like my mother said, who transitioned for, treat them with a grain of salt and a long-handled spoon. Ooh. Treat them with love. Because see, love will cover a multitude. See, love will do it. Yeah. And you got to even pray for the ones that even just, because it's the Word.
True.
You even got to forgive the ones who done. But it's okay. I know that. And I see them. But see, sometimes, here's my other motto. I move in silence.
Oh my God.
I let my feet testify because the evidence is going to speak.
Yes.
So even when all of that, they seeing all of this. They seeing the travel. They seeing me on the radio. They seeing it. It's not for me to brag, but it's all for his glory.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't get stuck right there. You let them keep right on because they have it. The best, and what my bishop says, son, the best is yet to come. They haven't even seen the best yet. It's on the way. Any day. I know I'm going to be wealthy. I know I'm going to be a millionaire because what I want to do for the kingdom, what I want to do to be a blessing to my pastor and firstly, what I want to do to be a blessing to the homeless and build this shelter. So the thing about it, it's all about the kingdom work. It's all about him. But see, so when, and I know it, I can look, I can observe, I watch, I pray, and I just move in silence.
Practice discernment, right?
I definitely got it. Yeah. And the thing about it is, I just move in silence. So when the manifestation, a lot of this stuff, being on the magazines, in magazine, all this, I didn't share it with few. Yes. Right. My pastor, first of all, and first and foremost, I share with them, period. You know, because they're going to pray, they're going to cover me, but I need their guidance. I need their wisdom. But then it's those that I know are praying. Like when my buddy reminded me about that building, when he reminded me, he already sowed the seed first. Then he got it in the war room because he's praying, because I know his prayer life. So we all, listen, they haven't even seen it. So when they see the manifestation of it, listen, I already told somebody, oh, you're going to be running this. Yeah, so you got to have a plan. You got to have goals in it, but then you got to do something about it. Then you got to do the research. So even when people don't, and then the sad part about it is, it's enough for everybody. Why not be happy for somebody?
Yeah, absolutely right about that.
I push, listen, Critique Magazine, Vital Magazine, Upwards Magazine. Matter of fact, one of my friends came to my church, and we've been friends over 45 years. I sent to the CEO of Upwards Magazine, I said, you need to feature her. Phenomenal judge doing amazing work. So after I said, he said, she didn't respond. I said, she's the judge. Did you forget? Right, she's on the bench. Yeah. But anyway, he said, oh, that's right. But anyway, all the way from everyone I sent him, he never questioned it. One, my integrity, my character, my credibility. And so when I told her after I knew what time she got off, I said, check your message. She was so floored. She said, wow, you would, yes. Why wouldn't I? If this is why my pastor, Bishop Pender, and even from the later part, I'm going to always talk about them. And even for the life and legacy of a pastor, I'm going to always keep the legacy alive. The thing about it, because they taught so much. And the thing about it is, why wouldn't I help you? Why wouldn't I push you?
Exactly.
Why wouldn't I help you get to your next point? If I can be a help, if I'm on radio, why wouldn't I say, well, hey, here's a show. One of my buddies said, wow, you have made our job so much easier with this magazine. I have had so many people featured in some of these magazines, and they're like, wow, why wouldn't I help you push your dream, your vision? If I can help you, and not only that, then when you get there, just as long as you don't forget and know it's about God, but as long as you don't just say, hey, thank you for having me on your show. Thank you for featuring me. I appreciate it. You know, and you're helping them push the vision, push the brand, push the goal. You know what I mean? But if we can't help somebody, it's all in vain. Or as the song, if I can't help you, then my living's all in vain. If I can't help you, what good is it? Or as Dr. Miles Monroe said, why go to the grave full when you can go empty? Yeah. Why not help somebody else? But see, that's the part of why I know I'm so favored and blessed. Mm-hmm. I don't mind helping people. I don't mind blessing people. And I have helped people that don't even like me, or help people that don't even speak. Now, you know that. You know you got to have the Holy Ghost to do something like that. For people to turn around, I'm telling you, have given people money. Listen. And had to turn around, pray for them, had to turn around, help them, had to turn around. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but it's all about him. And that's why he will open doors. That's why he will make ways. One of my old bosses said, you going to be on TV? And I said, thank you for the prophetic word. Now, what I did, I was just not on, but one, not only two, but getting ready to be on, not three, but to be the fourth one. I sent him the link to it. Mm-hmm. Not in spite, but just to say, you see, you don't know who God going to send. He used that whole scenario. Wow. I could have took it or I didn't. I took it, and I know when I sent it to him, I know he probably said, wow. On these covers of magazines, I sent every one of them links. Yeah, absolutely, I did. Just to understand, to know. Because whatever transpired and you were trying to do, listen, I serve a mighty God. I serve a mighty God who is in control of it all. And the thing about it is, if we can't forgive, or if we hold bitterness, if we harbor and we do all that, let me tell you, you're going to hold up your own blessings. You're going to hold up everything. I could have, all of this that he did and all those, I just bought, let me tell you, from last, that whole summer, to I just bought 3 plane tickets. Mm-hmm. My stuff been booked. The conference, they said, we are so excited. Oh, and shout out to Miss Pat Rogers and them, y'all. Hey, if anybody's in the Florida, Sunrise, Florida area, I'm so excited about this open door. Sunrise, Florida, 13400 Sunrise Boulevard, the Doubletree Hotel, May 17th and 18th. You talk about meeting some amazing people. Miss Pat Rogers, you know, Bill Walsh, Ray Perez. Let me tell you, if you let God do it, He'll do it. You know, that's why I couldn't harbor all that. I would have missed all these opportunities, all these blessings, everything that he was doing because I'm harboring over because they tried to mess me up or, you know, they didn't do me right here and all of that. You better let it go. I'm here to tell you. Absolutely. Christ said, forgive. That's the first thing he uttered on the cross. You better let it go. Why? It will hold up yours. Why these people keep on going. Exactly.
But they say foolish is a dog that barks at the flying bird.
Listen.
Right. Going back to moving in silence, I say that to people all the time. Like, I'll post something a lot of times after I participated. And they say, well, why didn't you say anything? I don't feel like I have to impress anybody. I was given an opportunity. I took it. I may share it. I may not. Because I believe, for one, what's for me is for me. Mm-hmm. I don't have to say, oh, guess what? I'm doing so-and-so. It's not necessary, you know? It's and not. I feel like having a media platform like this, that if I'm not giving people an opportunity to share their story, what's the point of me doing it? You know what I mean? To be able to bring somebody on the show that may my listeners may not have even heard of, I have to do that, having a platform like this, you know, because you could have inspired about 5 to 10 people just from appearing on my show. I have a responsibility. I think that whatever you do, you have a responsibility to bring other people along. Mm-hmm. And if you're not doing that, what the heck is the point?
And that's something that's true that you said that. And then people's perception, and I always tell people this as well. You got to check people's motives and you got to check people's heart. Because you have all of that, you know. And it's amazing because I know I have a good heart. My mother had one. Like, literally, I get this on like sowing and seed, and she gave her body to science for them to find a cure for MS. And one of the doctors said to me when we went to the memorial several years ago at the Heinz Chapel in Pittsburgh, he said, you may not ever see him, and you may not ever meet him, but one thing you'll understand and know, she helped him. Mm-hmm. I couldn't even cry. And the thing about it was, is that even having platforms, when people too got to come in with the right mind, the right perspective, and the right motives, this is not just so somebody can see you now.
Right.
You've got to be able and willing to encourage, to inspire, or even to share your message. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes we, and please don't have no egos and all of that. Like, you know, don't get that people's giving you an opportunity. This is a blessing. It's an opportunity. It's a privilege. Yeah. People don't have to do anything. I don't care what platform they have. They don't have to invite you. That's why I said thank you. Thank you for allowing me to come back. It could have been another way. It could have been that I didn't have to come back, or I could have done something to take. That's why I'm telling you, integrity, character, and credibility. Proverbs 22:1. I'd rather have a good name than great riches. Mm-hmm. See, that'll get you all that. If you seek ye first the kingdom, all of that other stuff will be added. But the mere fact is that when you are able to help somebody else and you are able to give somebody a platform, you know, say thank you, appreciate it, because it doesn't have to be. And that's what we're for, to help somebody else, to inspire somebody, to encourage. I'm doing a show Wednesday, The Power of Influence. Be empowered and be inspired. What am I going to do to empower you? What am I going to do to influence you? Because it's either good or bad.
Mm-hmm.
We have the power of influence, good or bad. But am I going to use it in the good way to inspire you, right, to encourage you, to empower you, to uplift you, to help you, to make it? Somebody's dependent on you. I didn't go through all of this for me. I did it because I'm writing another book that's going to help somebody else. Mm-hmm. But if I hadn't experienced, how am I going to write about something I've not experienced? And I have not gone through, but I can tell them I'm on the other side of it. And this is how I got to the other side. And a lot of times we're not transparent because that's people true. See this now. I've been working. Mm-hmm. I put in a lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
You
well,
know?
Well, I'm going to be a devil's advocate here about the power of influence.
Word, I don't like that word. That when people well, say
okay,
that.
Okay.
That's him. I'm all be, the time.
You know, because I'm always, because you know, I'm a person where if you believe something, if you have power, if you have conviction and you believe it, it can stand up to any question.
Yes.
You see? So I always ask myself, even with faith, you know, I ask myself the hard questions. So that's just my nature.
Yes, absolutely.
So in this day and age, with because you said the power of influence. So why are you using your power of influence? Because you're a very influential man. Why are you using it to do good without any looking for anything in return? Or like, for instance, a lot of people right now are using their power and influence to benefit themselves.
Right.
Okay. But I'm hearing from you is you are in a situation where your desire to influence and use your power and use your motivation to help other people without seeing anything return. Why?
One is because at the end of this life, mm-hmm. I want to hear him say, well done.
Good. Okay.
Clear. And the conclusion of the whole matter. And the mere fact is that what is it going to do? Because still the word is still the word. Because if I'm going to do evil, if I'm going to do wrong, if I'm not going to do what's right, there is a consequence that comes behind it. Mm-hmm. And see, we're not looking at the now. We're not looking at or thinking about what it is. But at the end of it all, there comes a judgment. At the end of it all, you're going to be held accountable for everything we do in this life. Mm-hmm. And when at the end of it, I've got to hear him say, well done, because the other is depart. Mm-hmm. And people don't talk about heaven and hell and all that, but I'm here to tell you, you only going to hear one or the other. And so the mere fact, if I go through here doing all of this and go through all of this hell, what to hear him say, depart? No, because that's you going to spend an eternity. Either place, you going to spend eternity. And so the mere fact is, I have this. I've got it because people are dependent. It's so many people are going through so many different, we all are. Mm-hmm. But then he's given me the ability to help somebody. He's given me the ability to encourage. He's given me the ability. But then it would be a disservice to him.
Yeah.
And that's who it's all about him, because it would be a disservice. He's blessed me. He's opened doors. He's made ways. And yet, he sustained me in the midst of my wilderness. I didn't lose nothing. He sustained me and opened up another opportunity with a job that now I'm getting ready to speak for. He's opened up another opportunity where I'm going to all these different platforms. He's opened up another opportunity that he's blessed me. Not the mere fact, and he's kept me in the midst of it all. And yet, I'm going to use it to do something evil. It would be something wrong, and it'd be a disservice to him. Because my whole focus, I've got to please him. Because at the end of it all, like I said, I got to hear him say, well done.
Absolutely.
And people say, well, they, you know, they got their own, but yeah.
Okay, not that you need help, but let me show you how powerful this is, that book. You know, with throughout history, you know, from Egyptian history to Greek and Roman history, it was always a situation where they used to record history. They used to write stuff down. They used to inscribe it on columns. They used to inscribe it in artwork.
Yes.
Right. Not necessary. And the main thing is for posterity, long after we're gone. And you see that right there? Long after we're gone, that's still going to be around.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And that's heavy. That's real. I mean, I was looking at that, and not, like I said, not that you need help to put things in perspective, but that book or anything that we write or manifest from our heart, you know, from God to your hands to write down, mm-hmm. you know, is forever, and it's going to be timeless. You know, you ever put a lot of thought into that?
Absolutely. And okay. It's powerful you said that, because I was asked when, now actually April 25th, I'm doing a teaching and a book sign at the Enoch Pratt uh-huh. Library from 6 p.m. to 8 on Harford Road, right here at the Hamilton Branch on okay. the corner. So
my hometown, home branch.
Please come on. Please, that's where my book started at. Okay. So I'm doing book signing and a teaching there. And then that Saturday, I'm doing an event at the Cultural Arts Center from 7 p.m. to 11, bringing artists and authors and networking. And it's going to be really nice, 7 p.m. to 11. But the thing is, when someone asked me, and I said, it's not that it's just in the library, and it's not just because it's on the shelf, but someone will be forever reading The Power of the Seed. Absolutely. And the thing is, mm-hmm. I'm featured in the March and April issue of The Compass for the Enoch Pratt Library, and I'm on their website and also on the Writer's Live.
Well, that goes out to over 5,000 people. 5,000 people that will see the power of the seed, whether they buy it, but it's all, it's not if they just don't buy it, but there's all, it's a quote from there, but not only, it's a little bit about the history of it. They're going to be intrigued to pick it up. They're going to be intrigued to look it up. And I'm on the website, and I'm on, you know, doing the book signing and the teaching. So to hear fact is, it's not just because it's on the shelf. And then the last week when I went in there, because I had to do some, the typing when I had to send my stuff in, you know, for the anthology. And I got so teary because when I looked, I said, wow, this is really on the shelf in this library.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, yep.
But let me tell you how favor will change, that's my clothing line, y'all. Favor will change. Bless everybody that has tuned in. I love you with the love of the Lord. You know, I'll respond to them later, but it's a blessing. The favor of God, and this is my slogan, even on every social media, is better than money in the bank. Favor will take you where people money can't. When I asked that young lady in there, and she said, when she asked me if I had my ID, if I had a library card, do I have a book? She was going out on vacation. I kid you not, when she came back, it wasn't even 2 weeks. It was literally a week. This book was in the catalog for the Baltimore City Library, for the Enoch Pratt Library. I went to support Dr. Walters. I used to teach at his wealth seminars. Went to support him. Baltimore County Towson Library. I had never been in that library in the 25 years I lived in Baltimore. Went there to support him. I walked upstairs on a break. Didn't even know I was coming back down to do a teaching. And I said to the lady, I said, what do I need to do? My book needs to be in your library. So they looked at me, the Orient lady looked at me, said, well, we normally don't do this. That department's closed. Wait a minute, hold up. Little short lady came. She said, well, wait a minute. The manager's in the back. She went to get the manager, or she said, you got your ID, you got a library card? Absolutely, I have one. Didn't know that Baltimore County and Baltimore City, if you have one, they connect the two. And so I said, sure, here it is. I said, oh, by the way, my book is in the Baltimore City Library in the Enoch Pratt. Said, okay, let me see your ID. Fill out this form. We normally don't do this on a Saturday because that department is closed. But let me tell you how favor, and when you obey God, and when you support other people, not looking for nothing in return. I literally walked upstairs, and I had never been in there. They said, well, okay. I kid you not, it was Saturday. Friday, I get an email from the department head. Your book is now in the catalog. Baltimore County Library. So when you go to Baltimore County, and then I went to support my buddy Dominic when he did he does Toastmasters and all that. Went to the Baltimore County Library in Cockeysville. When the lady walked me down the aisle, lady must have been about 80 years old. She walked me down the aisle. When she pulled this out, I could have just broke down in that aisle. Why am I saying this? It's because it's the favor of God. Nothing but God. But not looking for nothing in return. But not being able, not being afraid to open up my mouth and ask him. I said, yeah, my book needs to be on your shelf. What do I need? But I was prepared. My ID, I was prepared. My library card, didn't know they connected two together. And now, when I go there, my books in these libraries, it's a blessing. It's the favor and faithfulness of God. Lord, you know I'm getting emotional. Just when I begin to think of how faithful God is, when I begin to think of how good he has been, not for what he's done, but for who he is. If he don't do another thing else, he's done more than enough. If he don't do another thing else, just because he's opened the door, not if it just because, who gets a book in a library in a week? Who gets a book in not only one, but 22 locations? Who gets a book in a library? In another library, 19 locations, and then 8 in Dauphin County. So when I went back, and I went to each one of them and told them thank you in person.
That's
and
awesome.
The one young lady said to me in PA, I'm so glad you came. This is my last day. I got a promotion. And I said, wow. I embraced her. I said, well, let me give you a book. Make sure you have one. We took pictures. And I said, that's the mere fact of telling somebody a thing. She didn't have to do that. A whole week and a half, my book was in that library. Wow. Dauphin County Library. And then not only that, April 7th, they asked me to be a speaker and a vendor at the Authors Festival. It is huge. Wow. In PA. Mm-hmm. God. It's nothing, you know, woo, I'm getting so emotional. It's nobody but God. I'm telling you, when you can just do it, not looking for stuff or being a blessing to somebody else, whether people like me or not, I will help you. And knowing that people don't.
Yeah.
But the mere fact, I know I'm favored and blessed. When my friend came, drove all the way from PA to join service with us, my parents said, well, wow, she just blessed me. She sits on the bench. She's hearing cases all day long. But to drive, to support me, and when people do, it's a blessing. It is a blessing. I write an inspirational word to 39 people. I had to drop off books last week to our other location of Hopkins. Then the chairman said, well, why not write an inspirational for the department? I said, I do. So let me tell you, it's all about God. He will open the door. I could have missed all of the opportunities, all of the blessings, because I'm basing it on something that what was, that could have been, to what is, to where it's going.
So you're definitely walking in faith.
Oh, my. Faith and favor.
Faith and favor. Okay. Yeah.
It's interesting because tonight I said what I said. Love with Dr. Holmes.
Love
with
Dr. Holmes.
Now, I didn't know what direction it was going into, but everything you spoke of was about love.
Yeah.
Love of people.
Love of self.
Love of faith. Mm-hmm. You know, and being able to add value.
Yeah.
To someone's life. Yeah. That's love.
It is love.
Yeah.
And we've got to love one another.
Definitely.
And how is he going to know we are safe if we don't love one another?
Yeah.
You know, and we've got to get out of this. I was just sharing this. We've got to get to getting our communities back, helping these young people. How are we going to be an encouragement to them? How are we going to bring them off these streets and off these corners? And we don't want to do that. Yes, it's crazy, but the word is still true. Mm-hmm. It's so much is going on, but the word is still true. It will not fail. God, there is no failure in him. But if we don't do something, if we don't stand up, we used to, you know, the community.
Yes.
Our parents, yes. The neighbors. Mm-hmm. I tell people, when my bishop said, go get houses, that's been 13 years ago. I went the next day. Mm-hmm. I have the best neighbors. Like, literally, I was telling my neighbor, they cut down this tree. And it's so amazing because I said, the power of the seed, because they only cut down here, but they couldn't cut down the root. Anything will grow back if it's not cut at the root. And so when I begin to think about the power of the seed and how the roots expand, and I said, well, I'm gonna get that bush, how much? When I tell you, she said, call me. How about my neighbor had the tree cut down, the bush that I wanted? My other neighbors, they have a key. They got, I mean, they get my packages, and I tell people all the time, they got the key to my, when I had to do a letter of recommendation, and one of my neighbors who's an officer, that Caucasian man said to me, he said, wow, you really love your neighbors. I said, sir, they got a key. They got the code to my security system. They have a key to my house. Mm-hmm. But that's the kind of I was grown up with. You know what I mean? We could go to the neighbors and they look out for you. We had guidance counselors. I've been out of school 30 plus years. My class of 86, I stay in touch with everybody. Yes. We get together every several months. Not only that, I was a keynote speaker. I write an inspiration every Wednesday from the class of 1980 to 1989. But when we had the reunion, it's a blessing because even though, you know, people see you, and that's why they got to see the change. Right. Now, I threw the best parties. I did all of that. You know what I mean? But one of my friends said to me, but you've always been the same. You've always helped people, no matter what, from being not saved to being saved. But I never judged them. If they call me for prayer, if somebody's going through, we did. Somebody's mom had just passed. I drove all the way back to Pennsylvania to be of support. But then my whole class bought my book. But it wasn't even about that. It's about the love. It's about the support. My neighbors, if they in a crisis, that's why you got to live so too. They call them in crisis. What? When we had that last tour, like literally they were calling me and they was like, we need you to pray. You know, and that's a testimony. That's integrity. And not only that, that's to God be the glory that they can call on you in a time of trouble. They can call it so many people on here from my class and support. It's a blessing. Mm-hmm. That's why I said every door opportunity, when I go to Florida, when I go, you know, to meet all these amazing authors in June, when I get here, you know, to end, it's nobody but God. When I get to Atlanta, to this station, it's just ain't going to be the same. But, you know, it's a blessing. It's a door of opportunity. Of course. And I was a blessing to my little spiritual brother. He turned around, connected me with the, see that? Wasn't looking, it connected me. His lady called me and bam. I'm going to be on the TV. That's why I said, let God do it. But when you do it with the right motives, yeah, and the right heart, it's all about the heart. It's a matter of the heart. Because out of the heart flows the issues of life.
What does that mean exactly?
We because in our heart, issues, and, you know, this the heartbeat. Without your heart, you ain't going to be alive.
Right, right.
We can contaminate our spirit. We can contaminate our heart with bitterness, whatever it is.
Right.
But if it's not right, because whatever's in you is coming out of you. I tell people all the time, you just give people enough time. You give them enough time. Bless you, Dr. Drew. You give people enough time. What's in them is going to come out of them. Oh, you just watch. Definitely. You just watch them. Because as they say, actions speak louder than words.
But do we react with unconditional positivity and love? Or do we guard and show discernment?
We've got to do it based on who we are.
Okay.
Because each individual is different. You may react different than me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it's a process. And then everybody's not in the same situation, or everybody's not in the same walk, or in the same timing or maturity. Let's in the right maturity, because somebody may have done something to you. You may be holding on it for the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. But me, I may have been a bit like, you know, I got to pray. I got to let it go. But then I'm watchful. Then I'll treat you with a grain of salt and a long-handled spoon. Now, you get me once, you're not going to get me twice.
Right.
Okay. So there's a limit.
You see what I'm saying?
There's a limit.
It's yes. You know, we got to forgive, because if I don't, I'm not going to make it into the kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's a requirement. People say, oh, you not, listen, if you don't follow the word, I can already tell you for surety, based on what he's already said in his word. So the thing about it is, but then you just got to proceed with caution.
Good.
Don't ignore the warning signs
right
now. Now, he'll send signs. He'll send them, but then we, so many times as he did with me, we ignore the warning signs. We ignore it, and then next thing you know, situations, circumstances, but he gave us warning. Believe it or not, he gave me, I remember going through this little program, and knowing when he gave it, I ignored the warning sign. It cost me over $3,000. But I tell you one thing, it wouldn't happen no more. Listen here, I don't care who's selling what, who got, listen here, if the Holy Ghost ain't, if telling you, if God ain't speaking, I'm serious. But he gave me the sign, and I ignored it, thinking, oh, this is going to help, and I'll be a greater black, you. No, everything
sometimes
is not.
Yeah.
You've got to be so prayerful and mm-hmm. so in tune now, and especially the times that we're living in. Everybody has more. Even a gentleman yesterday, he must have forgot, because one, he didn't see me dressed the way I was. And I watch him, and I know him, and I saw him. Because one time when I gave him some, then it was something, I watched him. But then he asked me for some, so I said, oh, no, sir. But see, he didn't recognize me.
Right.
Interesting.
Right.
Yeah.
He didn't recognize me. And same to another gentleman. I was dressed down, cut up, you know, so they normally see me in suits and all of that. That's why when John Mastermind Hudson, you know, asked me to, you know, put on these overalls and all this for the cover. But he saw a different perspective.
Right.
He was seeing vision. He was seeing the whole power of the seed and what it meant. Mm-hmm. But I trusted
you
him.
Said
and
that,
I did.
Yeah.
I trusted him, because normally that's not me.
Yeah.
Or even at my job, they was like, wow, we love it. The president sent me an amazing email. I was like, I love it.
Yeah.
But he took me outside of the box. He took me outside of the comfort zone. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times when you have people that really believe and see the vision and the dream in you, they can take it further.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of times, but I trusted and I just did it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I could have either did it or not. And so that's why we got to be so in tune, or we got to have faith enough to believe. And a lot of times when you know that people have your best interests at heart, yeah, that's why you got to be discerning, and you got to be very careful, because people have a lot of motives, isms, schisms, you name it.
Yes,
but who's to say that you didn't need that as a lesson?
And that's true. In everything, as my pastor's wife would say, you got to learn to see God in everything.
Yeah.
What have I learned in it? Even with that last, what have I learned in it? I know one, I wouldn't take another position. I don't care how much they paying.
Right.
Because even thinking it was a career move. But I learned a lesson in it. Because one thing it taught me, when I'm writing letters, when I had to write this next book, when I tell you, they taught me, because I couldn't mess up. And okay. she was like, you can, and I was sending letters to chairmen and based on the doctors and based on them getting jobs and, you know, after their residence. So it taught me something. And then if I don't know something, listen here, whether you want to talk to me or not, you're going to help me. You know what I mean? Because I was given tasks that I had nothing or knew nothing about, but I learned it. Because if I was able to apply for something else, I know how to credential these doctors. I know how to, all these documents, whether they need visas, whether they, I know all of that. So what have I learned in the process? Everything is a process, but what have we learned? Because it's easier to blame somebody else for mistakes, situations, whatever it might be. But what part did I play? Excuse me, what part did I play in it? What did I do in it?
I ain't do nothing.
So you're owning your mess.
Accountability.
Yes, yep. Absolutely.
Accountability. And the thing is, owner, we have this at Hopkins, you know, when they do orientation, you know, and I happen to be in the orient. That's why I don't let people mess up my integrity. And that's what they were trying to do. I said, I'm in these videos in orientation. Told that lady, absolutely not. Every time somebody come in here and go orientation, all these employees seeing me. Not only that, I have won every single award in that institution, from the highest, from the Edward Halley. Out of 24,000 employees, I was favored and blessed to receive that. They only give it to one employee each year and with a check. Then the Martin Luther King Award, two outstanding awards for customer service, the employee. And you think I'm going to let somebody mess up my integrity? Exactly. Absolutely not. Absolutely. So what have I learned in that process? My integrity, my character. And I would do it again. I would just do it a little different.
Right.
Yeah.
Lesson learned.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. But we've got to learn in the process. It's easy to blame people for situations and circumstances or, you know, what they did. Well, what did you do?
What's your role?
What is your part in
exactly.
it? Like in a play. What is your part in the play?
Right.
You've got to learn this because guess what? They may not show. Well, how about you might have to learn this part too? But what is your part in it? What have you learned in the process? Mm-hmm. And like I said, what my pastor's wife would always say to us, you don't know your purpose. Just do it all. He'll show you. Mm-hmm. But you've got to learn to see God in everything, or she'll say it like this. God pencils our day in. We may have calendars. We got phones. We got agenda. But God pencils our day in.
Absolutely.
Everything is done on purpose. So I tell people, live on purpose, with purpose, and then execute the purpose.
Okay. So where can we find you? Where can my listeners
where can we get your book? How much is the book cost?
Actually, you can reach me on the social media, Facebook, under Eric Holmes, on Twitter, Dr. E, Instagram, Elin K. 1115. My book's in the Baltimore County Libraries, Baltimore City Libraries, Enoch Pratt. If you happen to be in PA, Dauphin County, you can always reach me.
Camp Hill?
Yeah.
Camp Hill.
Camp Hill?
Okay, Camp Hill.
Paxton?
Oh, 8 locations, though. Not just Camp Hill. 8 of their locations.
Lower it's Paxton?
It's called Dauphin, absolutely, but it's called Dauphin County.
I'm very familiar.
So you got 8
there.
Locations. You got one on Front Street.
Yeah.
You got one on 3rd Street. So, you know, all those different locations.
City Island?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's where our class, we're having the, it's called the 80s reunion.
Okay.
We're going. So I'm glad to be a part of that, because I was asked last year when I was the keynote speaker. It's a blessing. I'm talking about a decade of classes, and to be asked to be the speaker for that Sunday morning. Let me tell you, it's all about God. So yeah, and they can reach me on any of the social medias. My book is on Amazon, Barnes & Noble. If anybody can contact me, I'll be glad to mail you one. I just mailed one. Hopefully, my friend is on. Hopefully, she got hers. I mailed it to Texas. So, hopefully, she got hers. And it's amazing because we met in conversation. We met, and not only I said, let me send the book to you. Let me sow this. Mm-hmm. And you don't know where people was, because it was a blessing. A gentleman sent me an email from Atlanta I've never met. He said, I know God sent you my life, because I was searching on Amazon and came across the power of the seed. But let me tell you, this email is a whole entire page. I was literally in tears because, one, I don't know them. God already knew, but the mere fact is that they took time to write that entire email, and I've been in touch with them ever since, and said I needed to know how to sow again, how to give. I mean, the whole thing was about church and, you know, how it had just, and then shared some things. I don't know them from nowhere. That they would put something personal and share. And not only that, how they came. It wasn't by accidental incident. It was purpose. God already knew. And then so I stayed in contact with them. You know, so it's amazing. So on Barnes & Noble, Amazon, I tell people, put a review. It's going to help.
Right.
Put a review. And so I go on there and I read them and I respond to them all. But I know it's going to be a blessing.
Do you recommend this for adults, teenagers, or because I have kids and they're avid readers. Is it something that you could that's appropriate for is the message can reach teenagers or?
Yes. It's for believers, non-believers, adults, children, because everything starts with a seed, even as you teach your children about seed. You know, even as you teach them, you know, everything starts, Christ being the ultimate seed, everything starts with a seed. We were a seed. You know what we eat? It's a seed. Everything starts with a seed. So if they were in school learning about fruit, well, where does the fruit come from? It's a seed.
Right.
So you got to use all these different analogies so they'll understand how powerful the seed is and that it grows. And as you water and as you nurture it and as you harvest it, now where does this big tree come from? Or if you look at this grapevine or you look at, you know, us as humans, we started with a seed. Mm-hmm. We were a seed. You know, so when they see these farms, wow, that was a seed. You know, so, yeah, you might be teaching them about farm life. They may be doing a science project. Well, let's look at these seeds or how these how they got all of this farmland. How do the animals eat? Everything starts with a seed.
Okay.
Well, we certainly appreciate you appreciate having you here. I'm so glad you said yes.
Yo, I'm honored.
This is like part two of our interview. So, Dr. Love, you were in a play this weekend, so tell us about the play.
It was very, excuse me, a very, very inspirational play. Very good, very well put together as far as the cast is concerned. Very well thought. When I say thought about, I mean from start to finish as far as creating the plot where it was, it will have you on the edge of your seats. Shout out to Sheree Harris and the whole cast of What If for coming together in such a strenuous time because it was like a lot of things were thrown at us. More say to not let this play go forth. And it still went forth and had a good time. It was sometimes to make you think and wonder of the situations that are actually going on today. And then there were some funny times, you know. Not intentionally.
I'm sorry. I'm trying to keep my composure.
Wait a minute.
I'm trying to keep my.
Don't tell me about the doorway.
No.
So
but the funniest line. The doorway is funny, but the funniest line where he was a police officer, right? So he rolled up on this guy who was a big guy. Actually, he was a radio personality as well. The Voice. The Bassman, that's his name.
Well, see that's Marcellus.
Gotcha.
Marcellus Shepherd.
So, yeah. It was some real some local celebrities there. But just picture this: he rolls up on him, and he turns around and looks at Nate and goes, "What beanstalk you climb down from?" I had to be. He said, "What beanstalk you climbed down from?" And it took me everything when you walked in here today. I was about to say that. That's all I was thinking about for the last 2 days. What beanstalk?
So the situation was, it's like when, shout out to John Selman for putting the whole stage together from like the doors and the walls and stuff. But where he failed to fucking realize is when you made this door, you didn't make the door thinking that I had to come through this motherfucker one day.
Oh,
You didn't think I had to come through the door?
Yeah.
I'm just saying, like, so all of the doors would be where you all could fit through.
Hey, Nate, don't say you got stuck in the door, man.
Listen, Diddy. Listen.
So was it like the Kool-Aid? You know how the Kool-Aid crashed through the wall?
Let me tell you. So the first part, I had to go in to investigate. So I'm thinking I'm going to walk through the door. When one part got in and I thought I cleared the other part, and the other part... And I'm like, you know, so I'm trying to get through. I'm trying to be serious on this situation.
Yeah,
because I'm coming in to investigate.
It was some unexpected.
Everybody's comedy. Laughing.
Unexpected.
Everybody's
comedy.
Laughing. Everybody just thought
you
that this was part of the.
Composure.
So I kept my composure, okay. Queen. I kept my composure.
Stayed in role.
And I stayed in role. And I went on and I sat down.
Okay.
Did the questioning and the scene, the different things like that, knowing.
You got to go back.
I got to go back through that door.
Oh, my God.
To leave.
You should have walked around it.
Now, mind you, I should have, but then, I could have made it so that they had a back door.
But this
was the door to the main door, to their apartment.
Yeah,
so I got to walk through it. I got to go back through the door.
He can't walk through the door and go home through the balcony. You know what I mean? He had to go back through the door.
Listen, so I had to go back through the door, right? Now, let me tell you, I just want everybody to understand. Like, okay, you see your door?
Right.
Take a half of an arm off your door.
Oh, my goodness.
That's
right.
How thin the door was.
Oh, Jesus.
So, okay. So to try to get through that.
You tried to turn sideways.
Yes, he did.
Sideways didn't even do it either.
He had to. You ever see somebody swim through a door? He had to go like this through the door.
I got snagged through the door. So now we're on the second part. Now I have to do the arresting.
The beanstalk scene.
The beanstalk scene.
Oh, my God.
Which, yeah. Yeah. So my whole thing is that now, okay, I'm hoping that I can get, first of all, the way this entrance didn't have a door. It was just an entrance.
Okay.
So I'm thinking,
it's wide.
I'm a clear.
Right.
I'm a clear. I walk through. The minute that I get this shoulder in and I turn, this shoulder snagged everything to the point where
your shirt's torn.
Everybody had came from the back
to hold the wall.
To hold the wall.
The whole set
was about to come down.
So he's coming through, and then everybody went and held the wall up.
Oh, held the wall up.
While he came through.
So I'm saying to myself, like,
Jesus.
Okay.
Right.
So I said, okay, this can't happen
again.
Fourth time.
Yeah.
I'll be damned if it happened again. And when it happened... I cleared Marcellus through the door.
Now this is when y'all did the curtain call?
No. This is when the dean said take him away.
Yeah.
So I cleared him.
Pushed him through. Yeah.
But then when I go through, I'm snagging the gun belt, belt,
God.
The everything. So mind you. Now, when I go through, there are people on the other side of the wall that are doing this.
Oh, my God.
That's all of the thing.
We didn't see that.
I've done my scene.
Okay.
It's over. Okay? It's over. Wow. The rest of the show goes now. The show is over. Okay. So now we're at that part where we're starting to welcome people out.
Okay.
We want to introduce everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They says... Nate Brooks as Detective Kirkwood. Six people went and held the wall
while
I came back out.
Yeah.
as I came back out.
Through the door. Wow.
And even when I came out, they left the wall, right?
Right.
And went back and started to clap. Guess what happened?
What?
The wall
came down.
Oh, my God.
Wow. What was over with
that? I'm already cleared it.
Right.
The whole wall said, you know what? The minute y'all let us go,
I'm done.
I'm coming down. So I have to say, like I said again, shout out to the What If crew. We did an awesome job. We came through with it. You understand what I'm saying? But when I came through, that's what you call bringing the house down. That's what you call bringing the house
down.
You know what I'm saying? So I brought the house down. You know, but other than that, we did it was awesome. It was basically
just need a new set designer.
Next time what we're going to do is they're going to
measure it.
Measure me. then they know about the circumference of the
He's back.
Oh, God.
Then they know about the circumference of the door. You understand what I'm saying? So it was basically a good play. For those who missed it, you missed out. And basically, it's about a reunion of high schoolers.
So basically,
basically, the play is basically about you got college reunion coming back.
Okay.
One of the main character, two of the main characters. Well, one of the guy is the governor's son. So when you're a governor's son and you have so much clout in a city, and you're also a part of a fraternity, and you're also the pastor. So now it's like you feel like you're untouchable. So when he decides that he wants to go to an extreme,
he was influential.
He would go to the extreme to rape a young lady that he had feelings for, and basically said to her, you know, if you say anything, I'll make it hard for you.
Right.
A lot of people get into those situations where the person in power can make it so hard for you after they've done whatever they wanted to do to you. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And she decides to go on a drinking binge, and then she decided it got to the point where she wanted to pull a gun out, and she shot two people. Two people that didn't mean to get get shot.
Okay.
She was trying to shoot at him and missed him and shot two other people. So, you know, it was more say, a lot of people say, well, you know, she should have been shot. Well, she should have been in jail because she shot two people. But the main situation, it was that, you know, we wanted to get this guy who was been doing, who's been raping these women for 10 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Untouched. You know what I'm saying? Like, nobody would come and
come forward.
So he was like an R. Kelly.
Yes. So, yes.
Next week.
Exactly. So, you know, his mind was telling him, his body was telling him, or his mind was telling him no. But his body was telling him yes.
Exactly.
You know, so now it's like, you know, we've done the show, which was only one night. A lot of people felt like it could have been more than one night.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I think that October? We go to Atlanta. So now they're trying to judge it, whether they want to do the play again, or they want to turn.
They should do another.
Or they want to turn it into a movie.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good thing, you know. Like I said, shout out to, you know, the What If crew. I love all of them. That's like a new family.
It is. I watched y'all interact.
Yeah,
and it is like a big family. Which
brand new family, you know.
To work together, we're very proud of you. I know you did an excellent job. I'm glad that Quiet Storm was able to.
Didn't even know he was there.
I'm moving silence, man.
Listen, exactly.
That's it. Moving
but
silence.
But see, here's the thing. I didn't know he was there, but then to see him coming down the stairs and just straight laughing. Like, it wasn't a laughter to say hello. It was a laughter like,
I saw you
trying to get through that door.
No, man. No, for real. I wasn't laughing at that. I'm telling you, when that man turned around and said, "What beanstalk you climbed down from?"
That did it for you.
Because, okay, so if you're familiar, you know who Bassman Rosellis is.
Yeah.
The one who used to do 92Q, Slow Jam, right. Talk Slow. So when he turned around, he's here.
Yeah, he's short.
So he looked straight up. And with that voice, yeah. You know,
what base?
Damn, Goliath, what beanstalk you come from?
But you know what?
I mean,
but from my and you know, I'm gonna keep it real. It was a good play. It was a lot of different levels, which is very hard to do for a play because you only have a limited amount of time to tell so many backstories, and she was able to capture that.
Wow.
You know, because it was a lot.
Where was the play at?
It was down at Bowie State University.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was.
Who put the play on?
A young lady by the name of Cherie Harris,
Sweet Pea,
which she has her own production called Sweet Pea 23.
Yeah.
Productions. Okay. Mm-hmm. So and actually, she's getting ready to graduate this month.
Okay.
From Bowie.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So
I would love to see her do a play where she had
awesome.
Financial resources.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Because it was like I said, it was well written for what she was working with.
Was in the audience of playing the scene.
Because it was a lot of stories.
About quality and being, you know what I mean, and putting things in your integrity and your quality and you know, quality work that people will, because you never know who was sitting there, who watched it, or who might have seen it streamed or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, and people will. But if people believe in your vision, people believe in your dreams. I'm telling you, people will sow. People will help. And what do you think happened to Tyler Perry? That lady paid for his food right in that line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she and all the things she said, she don't want anything. She was led to do it. But 20 years later, I put it in my book, 20 years later, he calls her. And how about when she lost her job, her house was in foreclosure. Well, you already know the history.
Right, yeah.
But he remembered her. And he said that, and I got an email that called, "It may take a while," and it deals with the seed.
Yeah.
It may take, he said, but just do it from a pure place and do it from a pure heart. And 20 years later, he calls this lady, researched it. She didn't know, remember, you know, she didn't remember because she did it 20 years. So the seed had to show up at the exact time and the timing and the seed. So it couldn't show up early, couldn't have showed up late. Mm-hmm. She didn't need it then. She needed it right then. So 20 years later, the seed germinates through the underground to get to when she really needed it at the set time and season. So, and people will. And he been doing...
Right.
Ever since, you know what I mean? Even with failed plays, and he said it was just the last one.
See, that's something that's something I truly believe in because I've been saying that for years, but just in different ways because I do believe in do unto others or, you know, you give somebody a blessing. Like I've done countless random act of kindness, right? And not looking for anything in return because I truly believe that I'm going to get blessed or my family member, my kids or somebody might receive that blessing I would never know.
Right.
And I learned that from my dad, you know, where you do things. And I see that in my son.
Wow.
I see that he's 11-year-old where, you know, I used to, like, for instance, I was... Recently, it snowed, and I always get up and shovel my neighbor snow when because she's an elderly woman. So now he's at that age. I was like, "Go shovel the snow, Daddy. Don't have to do that no more, right?"
Wow.
You know, he shoveled the neighbor's snow, and she gave him like a whole tin of cookies. Right? He only made cookies, right? But he was appreciated for it. And I said, "How'd that make you feel?" He said, "It made me feel good." I said, "You see, you do positive things or you do the right thing when nobody's looking and things will work out."
And not only that, a seed was planted, though it wasn't money, but it was the love that was given.
Absolutely.
It was in showing him that there's people that still care or there's appreciative, being appreciative.
Absolutely.
But the thing, he'll see it and do that to somebody else, you see. So something already was planted, love and positivity, because nowadays they could be doing something else.
Wrap up. I want to again thank Dr. Holmes for joining us tonight.
Very, very appreciate your message, man.
It was definitely
very
inspiring.
Inspirational.
I just wanted to share one thing. You mentioned you never know who's watching. So I had a young man approach me about doing an 8-minute segment on National Broadcast Radio. I did the segment. I thought I sucked. The executive producer called me the next day and asked me to do a 30-minute broadcast, and that'll probably be next Tuesday. So they're sending that 30-minute broadcast out to probably about 750,000 people. And I talked about holistic health on that segment, and they had that day, that 8-minute segment was the highest rated segment. Wow. I was like, I thought that,
somebody else's perspective.
That's right.
You know what it was?
But we're more critical about that.
You know what it was? The hair.
That's what it was. They can't see.
The red hair. The red hair. The red golden hair.
You never know who's watching. So you always
Little
have
red
to be
riding
protective
hood.
Of your brand. You have to have integrity in how you project yourself.
Absolutely.
Because
Absolutely.
It definitely makes a difference.
It
so,
does make a difference.
Thanks again, Dr. Holmes, because
Thank
this
you.
Has been a great show.
Thank you.
And I appreciate you Thank giving you. Us your time. And so we'll post the show on Facebook on the Intimacy Chronicle group, and you can also download it from Spreaker.com.
And MixStation Radio
and
Live.
And MixStation Radio Live, yeah.
Thank you,
Thank
folks.
Thank you, and we will see you all next Monday. Same time, same place, and good night.
Deuces.
Dollar dollar bill, y'all. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar dollar bill, y'all.